You're watching the Emmy Award-winning Jim Heath channel on YouTube. Please give the video a like, subscribe to the channel, and give thanks by hitting the button below. Thank you for watching the Jim Heath channel exclusively here on YouTube.
For U.S. Marines in Lebanon, 1983 brings the carnage of a terrorist attack.
I don't think that the secret weapon of the future is the laser beam or the particle beam or the MX. The weapon of the future is the five-ton truck with a kamikaze driver.
For South Koreans, 1983 brings tragedy in the skies caused by Soviet miscalculations.
Reactions to the Korean airliner tragedy are a timely reminder of just how different the Soviets' concept of truth and international cooperation is from that of the rest of the world.
For Filipinos, 1983 brings political assassination.
My husband always believed that courage like cowardice is contagious. It is as easy to be infected by courage as by cowardice.
And for the world, 1983 brings the superpowers to the brink over deployment of nuclear missiles in Europe, threatening the peace of nations and the survival of the planet.
I think very few people are in support of nuclear weapons. I think we recognize that it's Armageddon. It's the end of the planet as we know it and the end of human life if these things are ever used.
Throughout the year, nuclear deployment by the U.S. and USSR and the quest for nuclear disarmament by millions of people are of major international concern. President Ronald Reagan and Soviet leader Yuri Andropov, just months in power after succeeding Leonid Brezhnev, wage a war of words to sway public opinion and try to convince the world that peace is their only aim. But the U.S. and USSR already possess strategic nuclear arsenals of about 10,000 warheads each. And each warhead is more powerful than the atomic bomb that leveled Hiroshima in 1945. By his third year in the White House, Reagan has upped the ante even more, claiming that the Soviets still have military superiority. Now the U.S. is scheduled to deploy the MX missile at home and 572 new intermediate-range cruise and Pershing nuclear missiles throughout Europe under the NATO umbrella. While European governments vote in favor of the new missiles, a majority of their citizens and the nervous USSR demand a halt.
We cannot do anything with Americans. This present administration in the United States.
It's like a mountain.
At Greenham Common in England, where 96 new missiles will be pointed at the Soviet Union, a women's anti-nuclear coalition camps out and protests throughout the year.
I don't think our government is prepared to defend Britain against a nuclear war. The biggest threat to the country is the nuclear war, not the Russians or anybody else.
Hundreds of other demonstrations against deployment are staged in Holland, Italy, and West Germany.
They are not for us so-called medium-range missiles. They reach the Soviet Union, whereas SS-20s that have threatened us for very long, also SS-4, SS-5, do not reach the United States. That is the difference in the situation. It's the second Cuba missile crisis now on European soil.
In the U.S., a train suspected of carrying a payload of MX missiles rolls through the scenic Wyoming mountains. Sentiments for a nuclear freeze are exploding here, too, as protesters attempt to block its path.
We can't stop the train by being here. We can educate people and bring people's awareness of the process, political processes such as the nuclear freeze, which can stop the train.
Protests continue in Colorado, in California,
The message is that actions like this are not just a way of expressing our feelings, they're a way of exerting power, the power to change ourselves, to change history.
In New York State,
Jesus gave it to
and in Washington, D.C.,
we are told that we must deploy this missile to show will. It's mutual assured machismo. I think everybody in the world would be much more impressed if we did not deploy the missile and showed common sense.
In Geneva, at the Strategic Arms Reduction Talks, or START, U.S. and Soviet negotiators attempt to settle on the number of missiles facing off on European soil. Except for propaganda, nothing is accomplished.
The United States is committed, firmly committed, to arms reductions. It is a priority of our president.
All depends upon the American side. If it is constructive, there can be a way to a solution.
This year?
Why not? But what is needed is the constructive response of the American part to the Soviet proposals.
As U.S. and Soviet relations dip to their lowest ebb in more than a decade, sharp exchanges between Washington and Moscow increase.
The door to an agreement is open. It is time for the Soviet Union to walk through it.
Reagan paints the Soviets as belligerent warmongers in order to persuade Congress to support his own massive defense buildup. And he turns up the rhetorical heat.
I believe that communism is another sad, bizarre chapter in human history whose last pages even now are being written. They are the focus of evil in the modern world.
The next day, the Soviets respond that Reagan's, quote, bellicose, lunatic anti-communism, unquote, is endangering peace. 2 weeks later, Reagan adds a new and, for many, destabilizing dimension to the arms race when he introduces the concept of a high-tech laser and particle beam defensive shield in outer space to fend off Soviet nuclear missiles. Named Strategic Defense Initiative, the public comes to know the program as Star Wars. While some talk, others fight, and the blood feud in the Mideast continues, Lebanon is the arena for nearly everybody's battle as it staggers through another year of violence, this year with tragic consequences for America. In 1982, Israel invaded Lebanon to rid the country of the Palestinian Liberation Army and its leader, Yasser Arafat. Israel succeeded in getting the PLO out of Beirut, but its army of nearly 40,000 soldiers was then stalemated throughout Lebanon by its old enemy, Syria, which had an equal number of troops there. After the Christian massacre of Palestinian civilians at the Sabra and Shatila refugee camps, and the return of the U.S. Marines as part of the International Peacekeeping Force, neither Israel nor Syria would give ground. In 1983, Lebanon is a crazy quilt of bitterly opposed ethnic, religious, and political clans, each vying for power, and each backed by a strong ally. Various Christian militias backed by Israel. The strong Muslim Druze and Amal militias backed by Syria. And the Lebanese forces, the government's weak army, backed by the United States. There are other factions at war, too. The PLO still has some 8,000 soldiers in the Syrian-controlled Bekaa Valley. Iran has sent members of its Revolutionary Guard to wage terrorist attacks. And to top it off, the multinational peacekeeping force of American, French, Italian, and British have a total of about 5,000 troops stationed around Beirut. After regaining a sense of normalcy following the 1982 battles, Lebanon now heads more and more towards the breaking point as negotiations for Israel and Syria's withdrawal drag on. Civil war escalates as Muslim forces fight to topple the American-supported government of Christian phalangist Amin Jamil, who assumed the presidency after his brother, Bashir Jamil, was assassinated in 1982. In Beirut, in a maze of instability and conflicting agendas, U.S. Marines, along with soldiers of many nations, patrol the streets. American civilians go on with their day-to-day lives, largely untouched by the turmoil around them. For a brief time, stability looks possible. Then, without warning, the United States becomes the target of hatred by Islamic terrorists. A pickup truck with false diplomatic plates is allowed into the parking garage under the American embassy. Laden with 500 pounds of TNT, it explodes, causing the collapse of the floors above. Soldiers, civilians, and Red Cross workers scramble to extinguish fires and rescue survivors. The severity of the blast is underscored by the high number of Lebanese and Americans who perish. For days, the search for survivors continues as the rubble is cleared. Diplomats reassess, but reaffirm the American objective of remaining in Lebanon.
I'm sure that all of us feel here not only the sympathy and the tragedy, but also the necessity to continue our effort to find peace and stability here in Beirut, here in Lebanon, here in the Middle East.
47 people die, including 16 Americans, and over 100 are injured in the embassy bombing. The Iranian-backed Islamic Jihad, in its holy war against America, claims responsibility. For a city that has been torn by war for over 8 years, this attack against America is only another diversion in its search for peace.
Jail for that.
1983 Hollywood releases portray the pain and conflict of growing up and making it in America.
Shall we play a game?
How can I ask you that?
How about global thermonuclear war?
Fine.
Two young new stars, Matthew Broderick and Ali Sheedy, lose their innocence about nuclear war when they play war games. And when baby boomers turn 30-something, movie audiences delight in experiencing the big chill. In Flashdance, Jennifer Beals plays a blue-collar worker taking a bold new approach to the highbrow world of professional ballet.
I'm going to get to the bottom of this. This is a grave, grave mistake.
With a $1 wager, Dan Aykroyd loses his white collar to Eddie Murphy in Trading Places.
Come on, that's my call!
And Tom Wolfe's best-selling book about the Mercury 7 astronauts takes off to critical acclaim with the release of the movie The Right Stuff. America's public high schools are tested by the government's National Commission on Excellence in Education. And in 1983, their report comes out. For the most part, the schools fail miserably. The report states bluntly that the very future of our nation is at risk, sabotaged by a rising tide of mediocrity in our children's education. The statistics are alarming. 13% of America's 17-year-olds are functionally illiterate, unable to fill out a job application or read a training manual. Math skills are so poor that half the freshman college math classes are remedial.
Told the man that she was moving the end of the week.
Passing through the public school system no longer guarantees basic skills.
I don't know why they gave me a diploma, because I don't know nothing. I mean, I didn't know how to read, write, or speak very well.
The report places blame everywhere. Students watch more TV and read less. The teaching profession, plagued by low salaries and low prestige, experiences a shortage of bright, ambitious college grads. And parents, under increasing financial burdens, have little time to take active roles in the education of their children.
The economic pressure on teachers and on families has caused many of the best teachers to quit, has caused both parents to become engrossed in producing income, has created several million latchkey children to be reared by frustrated parents who are preoccupied with other work.
Though poor education is a national problem, America's schools are not under federal jurisdiction. Responsibility rests with the states and with thousands of local school boards, which don't have the means to implement the report's recommendations.
We're going high tech, and we teach the average kid in the United States 1 to 2 years of mathematics. Japan has 6 years of math. Russia has 7.5 years of math. They cover calculus, differential, and integral equations before they graduate. We've got to compete with these kids later on in a high-tech society. Our kids are not going to be adequately trained.
Excellence is going to cost. And I think the only way that that can be understood is to appreciate that mediocrity is going to cost far more.
Back in Lebanon, the struggle continues, and Ambassador Philip Habib negotiates an American peace plan which guarantees Lebanon's political independence and the withdrawal of Israeli and Syrian troops. It is finally agreed to by Israel, Lebanon, and several Arab nations. But in a harsh rebuke, Syria's President Hafez al-Assad refuses to sign the May Treaty or withdraw his large army. Assad charges that the U.S. is biased towards Israel and is attempting to prop up the pro-Western Jamal government against the wishes of the Muslim majority in Lebanon. Angry that he has not been sufficiently consulted by the U.S., Assad now sets out to destroy the agreement by fully supporting the Druze and Amal militias. This opens the door for a large-scale weapons supply by the Soviet Union.
Syrians were much more clever in sabotaging the so-called Pax, Israeli Pax or peace in Lebanon, in having their strong alliance with the Soviet Union, solid alliance with the Soviet Union, and using some Lebanese allies like me, Nabi Barri, Franji, to prevent Amin Jemail from signing the 17th of May agreement.
Then a new development further complicates the confused scene when militant members of the PLO, led by Abu Musa, revolt against Yasser Arafat.
Don't speak of respect. It is a trifle matter, a very trifle matter.
Claiming that Arafat has become too moderate, hundreds of seasoned PLO guerrillas defect to the hardline Syrians and begin battle with Arafat loyalists in the Bekaa Valley. Back in Beirut, battles wage throughout the summer for control of the strategic high ground overlooking the city, the Shouf Mountains. Then, bowing to domestic pressure to reduce casualties, Israel suddenly abandons its control of the Shouf and retreats southward. In the absence of Israeli military might, the Lebanese armed forces and the Muslim Druze militia escalate their battles for control. And in the valley below, the U.S. Marines, defending the Beirut airport, become sitting ducks for the Muslim militia artillery from the Shouf Mountains.
See him up there? Straight out in front of us. The building with the orange curtain on. It's to the left of it.
In August, two Marines are killed, and President Reagan sends more combat ships to join the naval fleet already positioned off the Lebanese coast. As the summer continues, more Marines die.
There's always that bullet that's going to be marked with your name. That's not the one you worry about. The one you're worried about is the one that says, to whom may concern, on it. And those you just can't predict. You don't know when they're coming, and they just are going to get you. I think if the turmoil keeps going on, we're going to get some more casualties, yes.
In retaliation, Reagan shifts his policy and orders U.S. warships to fire on the Muslim positions in the Shouf Mountains, which also aids the faltering Lebanese army in its struggle with the Druze. This is the first time since World War II that American ships open fire in the Mediterranean, and the U.S. now digs itself deeper into the conflict. No longer a peacekeeper, but a full partner in the war. In a series of firsts in America, Harold Washington becomes the first black mayor of Chicago. When the shuttle Challenger lifts off, Sally Ride is the first U.S. woman astronaut to be carried into space.
The thing that I'll remember most about that flight is that it was fun, and in fact, I'm sure it's the most fun I'll ever have in my life.
New York City celebrates the first centennial of the Brooklyn Bridge.
Miss America. Here's Vanessa Williams, Miss New York.
Vanessa Williams is the first black woman to be crowned Miss America, but is forced to give up her title 10 months later when erotic photos of her appear in Penthouse magazine. Michael Jackson's Thriller is the first album to have 5 number one hit songs, and it goes on to become the largest selling album of all time. And we lose the America's Cup to Australia, too, the sailboat with the revolutionary winged keel. It's the first time in 132 years that America hasn't won a cup final. On August 31st, a Korean Airlines jet, Flight 007, leaves New York City's Kennedy Airport bound for Seoul, South Korea. What begins as a routine commercial flight becomes a massacre, the victim of an international fiasco, and the focus of a superpower face-off.
At 18:21 hours, the Korean aircraft was reported by the Soviet pilot at 10,000 meters. At 18:26 hours, the Soviet pilot reported that he fired a missile and the target was destroyed.
KAL Flight 007 strays off course over 100 miles and flies over Sakhalin Island, the site of a Soviet Air Force facility. The Korean airline pilot's radio communication with the Japanese was routine, indicating he was unaware of being off course and of being tracked by 8 Soviet jets. A single missile blasts the airliner from the sky, and it plunges into the ocean. All 269 people aboard are killed. The Soviets deny the shooting.
The world notes the stark contrast that exists between Soviet words and deeds. What can we think of a regime that so broadly trumpets its vision of peace and global disarmament, and yet so callously and quickly commits a terrorist act to sacrifice the lives of innocent human beings?
Within days, the Soviet position is challenged when faced with indisputable evidence.
On this tape, you will hear the voices of pilots of Soviet interceptors, including the Su-15 pilot who pulled the trigger which released the missiles that destroyed the Korean Airlines flight 007.
I've already approached the target to a distance of about 2 kilometers. The target is decreasing speed. I'm dropping back. Now I'll try a rocket. I'm closing on the target. I'm in lock-on. I've executed the launch. The target is destroyed. I'm breaking off attack.
The Soviets then amend their position, falsely claiming that KAL-007 had been cruising without navigational lights and failed to respond to internationally known visual gestures by the Soviet jet commanding it to land. The airliner, the Soviet pilot claims in a television interview, was then believed to be a military intruder, therefore a legitimate target, and was destroyed to protect Soviet interests. Emotions run high. 100,000 Koreans gather in Seoul to mourn their dead. And family members take ferries off the coast of Japan in order to grieve their losses. Always under the watchful eyes of the Soviets. Protests around the world spark heated condemnation.
We have seen their total disregard for the value of human life.
President Reagan harshly attacks the Soviets and bolsters support for his Cold War agenda.
And make no mistake about it, this attack was not just against ourselves or the Republic of Korea. This was the Soviet Union against the world and the moral precepts which guide human relations among people everywhere. It was an act of barbarism.
The mysteries surrounding the downing of KAL-007 have never been solved. News organizations and government sources speculate that a faulty onboard navigation computer guided the flight crew off course, and that the Soviet pilots, acting on the presumption that it was a spy plane, reacted without verifying the identity of the plane as commercial or military. The Soviets, embarrassed by the flaw now discovered in their air defense system, dismiss high officials responsible for the KAL-007 massacre. In Beirut, U.S. warships continue to pound Druze positions in the Shouf Mountains. Although the Marines find brief moments of peace, their involvement in the conflict escalates.
Since about 10 o'clock this morning, the Marine positions on the northeast corner of Beirut International Airport have been under small arms fire and rocket-propelled grenade fire. They have returned small arms fire in defense of their positions.
We know there are hazards there, and no one can feel more deeply about the loss of life, the wounding of some of our men there. We knew it was a hazardous undertaking when we joined in the multinational force.
Four days later, Marines suffer the single largest loss of life since Vietnam when their four-story barracks in Beirut is leveled by another truck filled with explosives driven by a single suicide terrorist.
I didn't know what hit us. You hear about 1,000 people, it seemed like, screaming, "Help me, God help me."
Oh, hell, we're still digging them out. There's casualties, yeah, but right now we haven't the slightest idea. As far as numbers or anything else, we're still looking. Right. We've got dead and injured, and that's all I can tell you.
This occurred this morning at about 6:20. Shortly thereafter, there was another explosion down at the French headquarters, a similar type truck bomb
We figure it had to have at least 2,000 pounds of TNT. It was observed coming at a high rate of speed from the south of the building, crashed through the gate and through the guard post, and then detonated inside the lobby. There's a crater down there about 30 feet deep and about 40 feet across. There's only pieces of the vehicle left. All four stories of the building imploded down upon one another.
There were 300 men asleep at the barracks that Sunday morning. In all, 241 soldiers, most of them Marines, perish in the rubble.
And I think the worst feeling was to start hearing noises, tapping or moaning behind solid walls, behind solid concrete. That was, I could feel the terror in there, in people's hearts, wondering what it was like to wake up in total darkness and not to know if anyone was even going to know you were there.
For the next several days, exhausted Marines race against the clock in their search for survivors.
Although, you know, how bad I try to hold it in, tears run from my eyes. It's the most devastating thing I've felt in my life.
In the U.S., many families have long, anxious waits for word of their loved ones.
My name is First Sergeant Stark. I would like to bring you some good news about your son.
Please.
Yes, ma'am. He's okay.
Back in Beirut, the digging continues, and Vice President Bush surveys the carnage.
We're not going to let a bunch of insidious terrorists, cowards, shape the foreign policy of the United States. And they damn sure hadn't shaken the courage of these men. And that comes through loud and clear.
The new wave of terrorism that destroys the barracks is a stark reminder of America's vulnerability to hatred in the Mideast.
We have strong circumstantial evidence linking the perpetrators of this latest atrocity to others that have occurred against us in the recent past, including the bombing of our embassy in Beirut last April.
According to news media reports, the lone driver was Lebanese, part of a Shiite Muslim splinter group. Sources later point the real finger of blame at both the Syrians and Iran's Ayatollah Khomeini. The religious fervor stirred up by the Ayatollah Khomeini in Iran is a dangerous mix of fundamentalist Islam and politics, producing a population of fanatics who will do anything to rid the Mideast of the Western Great Satan.
What I heard from a man that was on Pulse 7 at the time, he says as the man went by, he says he always remembered that the guy was smiling.
Still staggering from the massacre at the barracks in Beirut, Americans awake just 2 days later to find Marines again at war. This time in our own backyard, on the once peaceful Caribbean island of Grenada. Instead of playing a peacekeeping role, the U.S. military is here to rid the tiny country of a Soviet and Cuban-backed Marxist government that the U.S. claims is terrorizing the island. The communist presence began in 1979 when Maurice Bishop staged a coup and took over as Prime Minister of Grenada.
Many more democratic rights and freedoms and are much more involved and participating in the building of our revolutionary process.
But instead of democracy, Bishop and his new Jewel Party created a Soviet puppet state in the strategically sensitive Caribbean basin.
Bottom line is that the Soviet Union wanted to turn Grenada into another satellite, just like Cuba, just like Eastern Europe, with exactly the same methods. They wanted to indoctrinate the public, they wanted to bring them under control, they wanted to collectivize the whole economy, and they wanted to subject everybody to a totalitarian control.
The new Jewel Party was bitterly divided, and politics turned deadly when Maurice Bishop and six ruling cabinet members were brutally murdered by more radical party leaders. The Organization of Eastern Caribbean States, or OECS, a coalition of nine island nations, meet to denounce the new Grenadian government. At the same time the White House is hearing of the tragedy in Beirut, Reagan receives an urgent request from the OECS to help restore order and democracy.
Early this morning, forces from six Caribbean democracies and the United States began a landing or landings on the island of Grenada in the Eastern Caribbean. We have taken this decisive action for three reasons. First, and to overriding importance, to protect innocent lives, including up to 1,000 Americans whose personal safety is, of course, my paramount concern. Second, to forestall further chaos. And third, to assist in the restoration of conditions of law and order and of governmental institutions to the island of Grenada.
We do not have a tradition in this region of large armies. The other members of the OECS group either have no armies at all or armies of 200 and less. Now, if your neighbor develops an army of 3,000, this army is trained by Cubans, there and in Cuba, puts in an airstrip of 10,000 feet, which is more than adequate for its own internal domestic purposes. I believe that that is sufficient for you to say that you are dealing with people who are a threat to your security.
But I don't think this is an invasion, if I may answer that question. This is a question about asking for support. We are one region.
1,900 U.S. soldiers and 300 members of an OECS task force storm the island in a dawn raid. The strong resistance shown by the Cuban construction workers surprises U.S. authorities and clearly indicates that the Cubans are highly trained soldiers. After a day, U.S. forces take control of the airport and evacuate 650 Americans from the campus of the St. George's Medical School, where they're hiding from Cuban and Grenadian soldiers.
I felt I was in danger before Morris Bishop was murdered. And I tried to get out of the country, but I couldn't. I tried on Wednesday, October 19th, and was not successful. From that point onward, I felt I was not safe.
International press is barred from the island for the first 2 days, and reports are sketchy. Some reporters try to reach the island by private yacht, only to be turned back by U.S. warplanes and gunboats. In Washington, many congressmen and senators are upset by the Grenada incursion.
This is an act of war and raises genuine questions about whether it is a violation of the Charter of the United Nations.
Hang on, hang on a minute. In just 1 week, the mission's accomplished. The new Jewel leaders are captured along with 700 Cubans, and the hostilities come to an end. 18 American soldiers, 24 Cubans, and 45 Grenadians lose their lives in the hostilities. In the month-long mopping-up mission, U.S. forces uncover documents showing the direct involvement of the Soviets to be heavier than suspected. And a surprisingly large arms supply.
AK-47s with shipping markings from both Cuba and Soviet Union. There are obviously more weapons here than what can be used by a small local defense force on this island. Obviously a distribution point.
One destination point for Soviet arms is in Central America, where battles for influence are raging on many fronts. Military, political, and diplomatic. The Reagan administration fears that communism will spread from Nicaragua to neighboring El Salvador.
The emergence of another country added to Cuba, Grenada, Nicaragua, another country, and then perhaps others, to Soviet-Cuban influence is bad news for this country.
Reagan approaches Congress claiming that Nicaragua's Sandinista regime is exporting its Marxist revolution to rebels in El Salvador. And he asks for a large budget increase in aid.
Nicaragua's new army numbers 25,000 men, supported by a militia of 50,000. It is the largest army in Central America. There are additional thousands of civilian advisors from Cuba, the Soviet Union, East Germany, Libya, and the PLO. And we're attacked because we have 55 military trainers in El Salvador.
3 years after the assassination of Salvadoran Archbishop Oscar Romero, the young democracy in El Salvador has not yet implemented humanitarian reforms. Through small death squads, the army continues to murder private citizens and opponents. While Congress shares Reagan's wish for democracy in El Salvador, the budget increase is made conditional to demonstrated reforms.
We believe the administration fundamentally misunderstands the causes of conflict in Central America. We cannot afford to found so important a policy on ignorance. And the painful truth is that many of our highest officials seem to know as little about Central America in 1983 as we knew about Indochina in 1963.
Then, Albert Schauffelberger, a U.S. advisor, is the first to be killed in El Salvador, and the cost of U.S. involvement can no longer be measured in dollars alone. On Nicaragua's northern border is Honduras, where the U.S. is also flexing its muscles, staging war games and training anti-Sandinista rebels, now called Contras. Reagan is watched carefully as he walks a fine legal line, since a year earlier, Congress had passed the Boland Amendment, outlawing covert aid to the counter-revolutionary forces.
Covert action ought to be cut off. We ought to turn that action into an overt action. That's exactly what we did.
Throughout the year, Nicaragua plays the bullied underdog, fighting for its right to political sovereignty. Foreign Minister Miguel Descoto accuses the U.S. of planning an all-out invasion of his country from Honduras.
They conceived it, they are directing it, they are financing it, and the United States is also arming it.
In March, 1,400 U.S.-backed Contras do invade Nicaragua, but they fail to hold any vital ground. The Contras' future activity is deadly, but limited to isolated guerrilla attacks. The Nicaraguan government is more angered than weakened by the Contras. As Nicaraguans die at the hands of the Contras, the people rally around leader Daniel Ortega and his Sandinista regime. In the Philippines, President Ferdinand Marcos' nine-year imposition of martial law yields him powers that are almost dictatorial, usurping the democratic process. But because the strategic chain of islands is a former U.S. colony and a vital ally in the volatile Asian region, American leaders choose to ignore the lawlessness and corruption that keeps the country in abject poverty.
We love your adherence to democratic principle and to the democratic processes.
The battle has been joined, and the time has come for all Filipinos to take sides.
In August, Filipino Senator Benigno Aquino returns home after a three-year exile in America to lead opponents of Marcos in upcoming elections. Many supporters gather at the Manila airport to greet him.
The moment he steps on the ground, what does it mean?
Then Ninoy kept his word. What role he will play will depend on what they do to him.
The Marcos government, fearing unrest and not wanting his return, warns him of threats against his life. En route to Manila, Aquino is stoic but firm.
I suppose there's a physical danger because assassination is part of public service. Look at poor President Reagan. He got shot because Hinckley fell in love with Jodie Foster. So that's part of the hazard of the game.
My feeling is we all have to die sometime. Now, if it's my fate to die by an assassin's bullet, so be it. But I cannot be petrified by inaction or fear of assassination and therefore stay in a corner. I have to suffer with my people. I have to lead them because of the responsibility given to me by our people.
Upon landing, three government soldiers immediately come aboard to escort Aquino off the plane. But at the exit, the press is barred from following. A news camera captures a brief glimpse of government soldiers loading Aquino's body into a van before driving off, leaving behind the body of the assassin. The government claims that a lone assailant shot Aquino and was then quickly killed by security guards. The highly suspicious circumstances lead many to believe that the Marcos government did the job to keep Aquino from rallying the country against the repressive regime.
We want justice, yes, justice for all. But we want to know the truth first, so we know what the face of justice is.
Marcos appoints a panel to investigate the murder and denies responsibility.
I think the chances of the government of the Philippines engaging in a thorough and objective investigation of this assassination are nil.
Over 100,000 Filipinos turn out for Ninoy's wake. And his widow, Corazon, now speaks out in his behalf.
I would like the Filipino people in particular to remember my husband as a man of peace, as a man who loved this country very much, and who was really willing to do everything, even as you see at the cost of his life, to make things better for the people of our beloved country.
Aquino's assassination sparks unrest for many months. Demonstrations calling for Marcos to step down are recurrent events.
Filipinos want a free and clean election, and the only way we can do that is to make sure that Marcos is out of power. Why? Because with Marcos out there, we'll never have a free election.
A year later, government investigators conclude that Ninoy Aquino was the victim of a military plot. Yet in what is labeled a sham trial by the opposition, all of the accused soldiers are acquitted. But Aquino's murder is the flashpoint leading to the final demise of the repressive Marcos rule, as now a majority of Filipinos step up their demands for change.
I'm told I'm not entirely without charm, but I have no principles whatsoever.
Watch me.
As inadequate as most of us in this trade know we are, we also know that you have the right to expect at least honesty on this side of the box. And I leave now satisfied that I have given you that. For what is important is not that this program has meant almost everything to me, but that it may have meant something to you.
In Lebanon's northern city of Tripoli, besieged PLO chairman Yasser Arafat is in another fight for his life. Abu Musa's rebel PLO guerrillas, backed by the Syrian army, have chased Arafat and 4,000 loyal troops from the Bekaa Valley to downtown Tripoli. In December, totally surrounded, a defeated Arafat finally negotiates the evacuation of himself and his forces to Tunisia in ships flying the United Nations flag. For the second time in 15 months, Arafat suffers the humiliation of failure, only more bitter now, coming at the hands of fellow Arabs. Farther south, in Beirut, U.S. Marines are still reeling from the shock of the barracks bombing and from the heavy sniper and mortar attacks being leveled at them by Muslim forces. But as America becomes stalled in the quagmire of the Lebanon conflict, in Washington, a congressional investigation of the barracks massacre is strongly critical of both military and civilian leadership. Congress finds fault with security measures, intelligence gathering procedures, and with the chain of command from the colonel in Beirut up through the Marine Corps ranks to the White House and the president. Just after Christmas, Reagan attempts to put the tragedy to rest.
We have to come to grips with the fact that today's terrorists are better armed and financed. They are more sophisticated. They are possessed by a fanatical intensity that individuals of a democratic society can only barely comprehend. I do not believe, therefore, that the local commanders on the ground, men who have already suffered quite enough, should be punished for not fully comprehending the nature of today's terrorist threat. If there is to be blame, it properly rests here in this office and with this president.
And just 2 months later, despite repeated proclamations that terrorists won't affect U.S. foreign policy, Muslim forces in Lebanon achieve their goal when Reagan withdraws all 1,400 Marines to the safety of offshore ships. Another sad chapter in America's involvement in the Mideast comes to an end. In November, when the U.S. begins the actual deployment of cruise and Pershing missiles in Europe, anti-nuclear demonstrators hit the streets again, but to no avail. Soviet leader Yuri Andropov, critically ill with kidney disease, retaliates with threats of basing even more missiles in communist-dominated Eastern Europe. As a nervous world looks on with dismay, the arms limitation talks in Geneva come to an abrupt end.
That the present round of the negotiations is discontinued without any date set for their resumption.
Roger, copy. This is not an exercise.
Adding to global concern about the terrifying effects of these weapons, the controversial ABC film, The Day After, dares to imagine a world after a nuclear attack. And at year's end, at Greenham Common, the vigil for peace continues.
You're watching the Emmy Award-winning Jim Heath channel on YouTube.
please give the video a like, subscribe to the channel, and give thanks by hitting the button below. Thank you for watching the Jim Heath channel exclusively here on YouTube.